questions. This,
thank you.
Hello everyone, so I'm David. I'm finishing my PhD thesis at University of Louvain, and as part of my work I have implemented segment routing with IPv6 in the Linux kernel. So first I will present you what is segment routing exactly. So segment routing has been developed for now like 3 or 4 years by the IETF, and it is a source routing paradigm, meaning that instead of having each router deciding the next hop based on the final destination address of the packets, each packet contains a state, which are actually segments. And each segment is basically a sort of waypoint that can represent either a node by itself, so it means that the waypoint has to forward the packet to a particular node. It can represent an adjacency segment, that means that a given node has to forward the packet through a particular interface. And we can have also a service segment, and this represents a particular service that has to be applied to the packet. So it can be whatever network function that you can think of. The segment routing architecture is defined in this IETF draft. So, to show you a small example of how segment routing works, let's consider that small network. We have an ingress router here that will impose a segment routing header into incoming packets, and we have an egress router here. So let's consider packets are flowing in to the ingress router, and this ingress router sets an abstract segment routing header as follows. So this is the list of segments that the packet must go through, and we have a pointer which points to the first segment of the list. So first, what happens? We have the first segment, which represents node D. So what the ingress node will do, it will insert that segment routing header and look at the first segment. The first segment represents node D, and the ingress router will simply route the packet through the shortest path, regular routing, to the segment D. Then again, D receives the packet and inspects the segment routing header, and now sees that the current segment is segment B. And so again, it routes the packet through node B with the shortest path. Now we have a special segment here, segment S, that represents a service segment, for example, or any loopback function that must be applied. So node B will simply apply this this function to the packet, and note that only node B knows about this segment. It is a segment that is local to the node and not known globally by the network. So after applying the special function, the node B inspects the next segment and increments the pointer, forwards the packet to node F, as it is represented by segment F, again to the shortest path. And finally, the node F reaches the final segment, which is the egress router, which will remove the segment routing header and continue forwarding the original packet to its final destination. So initially, segment routing was developed for the MPLS flavor, and the idea was to get rid of the bunch of LDP tunnels that existed. But the problem is that with MPLS, you can only cover the core network. You cannot reach and host with MPLS. So for this particular reason, a version for IPv6 was developed and implemented. So how is it implemented? It is implemented with an IPv6 extension header, which is basically the routing header, and with a new type, which is type 4. So in order to prevent the same discussion that led to the deprecation of the routing header type 0, we added an HMAC TLV that enables to authenticate and verify the integrity of the SLOH that has been imposed on the packets. So this is how the segment routing header for IPv6 looks. So we have here the routing header, well, the general routing header. And the SRH is basically all this. So you can see that there is a list of segments which are represented by IPv6 addresses. And we have optional TLV objects. So when the SRH is first imposed on a packet, the segments left field and the first segment field is set to this segment, which is the last segment of the list, but the first segment of the path. So the first segment that will be encountered by a packet will be this one, and the last segment will be this one. So at each segment endpoint, this pointer will be decremented until it reaches the first segment of the list. So the HMAC TLV looks like this. So basically, we have an HMAC key ID which is 32 bits long. It is an opaque identifier that is defined by the operator, and we have the HMAC value that spans 32 octets. The standard hashing algorithm is SHA-256. So we can distinguish four basic operations for segment routing. The first operation is when an end host wants to impose an SRH onto a packet. So basically, that would be, for example, an application that wants to set an SRH for a given flow. So when building the packet, so it constructs the payload, and then before pushing the IPv6 header, it's just push the SRH on top of the payload and sends the packet into the network. The second operation is when it is an ingress node that inserts an SRH onto packets. So an existing packet arrives at the ingress node, and according to some classification, the ingress node will encapsulate the packet into an outer IPv6 header with the given SRH, and the original packet is not modified. The third operation is the segment endpoint. So it is when the packet reaches a segment endpoint that is in the middle of the path, and basically what it will do is it will inspect the SRH, it will look at the current segment, the pointer, and it will simply decrement the pointer and update the destination address of the packet to the next segment, and route the packet accordingly. The fourth operation is the egress. So when a packet has been encapsulated into an outer IPv6 header with an SRH, once it reaches the final segment, it is the egress node, and the egress node will simply remove the encapsulation and forwards the original packet to its original destination. So I will now present briefly the implementation of this. So three main features are implemented. So we have the packet processing, which is a data plane. So it means inspecting the SRH, updating the destination address, and so on. There is the control plane part, which means setting the SRH for incoming packet either as an end host or as a router, and the HMAC support. So the data plane part is basically implemented as extension header processing. So this is classically defined in this file. So nothing fancy about that, just updating the header and calling again route input to force the packet through the routing engine once again. And for the decapsulation process, so to enable a node to act as an ingress node, the header is simply removed, and the packet is reinserted into the interface. And as segment routing is an interfaceless protocol, if you TCP dump the incoming interface for a packet that reaches an ingress node, you will see the packet twice in the incoming interface. So the control plane part is implemented with lightweight tunnels. So you can specify classifications with the classical IP root command. So let's say, for example, you want some prefix to be encapsulated. So you just specify the encapsulation mode, which is segment routing, and you specify a list of segments that you want to insert onto the packets. And so this will work for either locally emitted packets output or forwarded packets. So in order for an application to impose an SLOH into outgoing packets, we support the setsockopt system call, which already existed to impose LH0 stuff, but we extended it to support segment routing header. And so this, when the kernel will construct the headers before sending the packets, just before pushing the IPv6 header, it will push the segment routing header into the packet. So there is a drawback for raw insertion of the SLOH without encapsulation, so for the end host. The problem is that some network drivers do not correctly handle IPv6 extension headers, and when we enable checksum offloading, it will get confused and not recognize the extension header. So this is an error message that is output by the IXGB driver that simply do not recognize this protocol, and this protocol means routing header. However, with encapsulation, it works perfectly well, including with GRO. So DHMAC is implemented, and its purpose is to generate valid signature for SLOH that we impose on packets and to verify the signature of incoming packets, which has the HMAC TLV enabled. So the HMAC, so we choose to implement the HMAC key ID as follows. It maps the value to a hashing algorithm and a secret. We can also add an expiration time that might be useful for management purpose. And this is controlled through a generic netlink interface. And we have a per interface parameter that says that either simply ignore any HMAC TLV you receive, verify the HMAC TLV if it is present, or enforce valid HMAC for every incoming packet. So as part of advanced use of segment routing, we have the service segment, which is more than node or adjacency segment. And a service segment enables to perform network function virtualization, because it simply means that the packet can go through a given virtual function. So the idea is that we have a segment endpoint that acts as the service segment. And instead of just forwarding the packet to the next segment, it will send the packet through a given virtual function that will process and possibly modify the packet and then send the packet back again into the network. So we had a whole master thesis dedicated to research about that. And so what we need is a transfer mechanism between the kernel and the user space. We need to be able to modify the packet into user space, and we need to transfer the packet back to the kernel for forwarding. So we attempted with my two students to do this with Netlink mmapped TX and RX rings. Well, it is not; it has been removed from mainline, but anyway, that was the first attempt. But we encountered problem with the window rings, with buffering, reordering, stuff like that. We had the problem that it is not GRO friendly. So for example, if you have GRO enabled, you receive a packet that has multiple segments in it, and it is sent to the application. The GRO information is lost, and when you try to send the packet back again to the kernel, it will say, wow, this is much larger than the MTU. It won't work. So we are thinking about other solutions. NFQ, for example, and what we'd really like is something that is able to transfer GRO metadata into the user space that can be sent back to the kernel to prevent that sort of stuff to happen. So perhaps an interface specific interface-based solution can be useful. So we are exploring that. If you have any suggestions, I'm all ears. Right. Sorry?
BPF program.
BPF, yeah, we thought about that.
Because I think the thing is, you can't remove, if you want to get away from the reordering issues, you can't remove the package, you can't remove the data processing.
My point is that if you want to get around, avoid the reordering issues and all those other complications, you can't remove the data plane from the kernel. You have to have the data plane processing in the kernel. You can't pop the packet into user space and expect to not have reordering it in some form or fashion.
Yeah, agreed.
Okay.
Thank you. So basically, the draft, ITF draft is fully implemented. We'd like to have some driver support for IPv6 extension header and some packet transfer mechanism, BPF, for NLV support. So I didn't talk about it in this presentation because it's not the purpose, but it's worth mentioning that segment routing enables some network programmability by leveraging the SDN protocol. So imagine that you have router and host that talks to some controller about some packet, and the controller say, okay, for that flow, whatever, you can impose this SRH. And then with the segment list, you can basically steer your packet through any path the controller says. You can make him follow any service function chain you want to. And you can do a lot of stuff with that. So I have already submitted a request for comment patch to the NetDev like a month ago. I will submit the actual patch after NetDev. If you want to contact me, you have my email address. I will be here for 3 days, so feel free to reach out if you want to discuss. Thank you, and if you have questions.
Where is the HMAC stored? Is it per net namespace, per root?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
The key for the HMAC,
yeah.
Where will you store it? Is it per net namespace, per root?
It is per namespace.
Okay, thanks.
So for the special segment, when you pop the packet to the user space, how do you remember the remaining segment information? Do you have table in the kernel or?
The segment routing header is transferred with the whole packets to the user space. So the user space, so with the attempted solution, the application had to make some parsing to skip to the encapsulated packets.
So the user space have to remember and keep the whole header back.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So as I understand it, the one interface mechanism for configuring this is the setsock option, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so it seems more useful to, like, I envision people would use this as a way to configure a cloud that a cloud of routing segments that packets flow through and the administrator wants certain kinds of traffic to go through it in a certain way, right? So it seems more useful to me to have this as a per route attribute or something like that so you could classify, match the route, and then all traffic that matched that route would have this segment header pushed onto it and then processed through the web of the mesh of their network to be.
Yeah, but the setsockopt option enables for more granularity, so you can let each application choose if it wants to impose the SRH or not.
But the person who makes the network would want to determine the policy.
Yeah, that's more of a design viewpoint. So if you want to make the
network. I'm okay with both points of view. I'm saying the setsock option is fine, but you should also allow an administrator to define how provide a way to encapsulate with segment headers for their network.
Yeah, but that's with the IP routes mechanism.
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, I see. I understand.
What if there's a contradiction?
Just repeat the question. What if there's a contradiction? What if your application is picking a segment header that is in conflict with what the routing decision would have been?
Well, you have to make it coherent, of course. We are assuming that we are within a single administrative domain, and Of course, if you know that your application are able to insert SRH, you will not force another SRH by the network.
But that may not always be possible, right? You do not know. I mean, if you're importing an application from somewhere else, the application may have chosen to put a segment routing header of some kind or a segment selection that is independent of the networking decision that's happening underneath in the network of the time. So, I would very strongly take Dave's position that it should be only the routing stack that makes these decisions. Now, you might be able to make some policies that refine them, but giving it a set sock op means that if there's ever a conflict, no one knows what the answer should be.
So, as I understand, like, network function virtualization is more like you want to allow an administrator and the application choose something consistently. So basically what you need is like a setsockop which just has an ID for I want to request a specific service. And yeah, then you want to have the IP route to actually specify which headers you need to accomplish that service. So you actually need a mapping from the setsockop which just requests I want to have this packet scanned by a virus scanner. And then the routing table implements the actually segment path to reach that virus scanner.
Yeah, well, the idea is that let's consider that you have some sort of controller and you have some application. Let's consider, some application that needs to knows that it will have to transfer a given bytes and needs a given bandwidth. It will make a request to the controller, having a global view of the network, including traffic engineering metrics. And it says, okay, you can use this path. And in order to use this path, I give you this SRH, and the application simply performs the set sockop, and the packet will follow the path that has been selected by the controller.
So if a particular segment hop is itself segment routed, will they nest in a rational manner?
So could you repeat the question?
If one particular segment hop is itself segment routed, will they nest?
You're asking if there is a special segment that represents self?
No, if so, in your earlier diagram you showed for a particular segment header for each hop, it says take the shortest path.
Yeah.
If that shortest path is itself segment routed through a separate segment routing instantiation, will it nest and work the way you would expect?
Yes, it will work. You have tried.
I think regarding route option versus socket option, I think this is very similar to binding a socket to a device versus source address selection through the routing table. It's exactly the same issue regarding what to prioritize. So this is not a new problem.
So you can just do both, right? Like if you do set socop of so mark, and then you set a routing rule that selects that mark, the administrator can choose what to allow, and the sockets and the application still has the freedom to pick something. So you can do both, right?
Yeah, right. No more questions?
So on a previous slide, I think you had mentioned something that drivers need to support extension headers.
Yeah.
Specifically, what do they need in that?
So that means being able to follow the header chain until reaching a transport protocol. Well, I think we can avoid that by setting the encapsulation flag to 1 and setting the inner transport header to the actual transport header after the chain of headers, but that's not really what it's meant.
But I mean, why is this in drivers? Is this for the offloads or some other reason?
Sorry, could you repeat?
Is this for like checksum offload and GSO?
Yeah.
Jira?
Yeah. Actually, I can clarify a little bit on the problem with IPv6 specifically. What was happening there, the reason IHGB had that bug is it was using the IPv6 header to try to determine the inner protocol.
Yeah.
And so, basically it was just getting to the point where it's like, okay, I don't recognize this protocol. I'm assuming you must have been working with some older code there because that bug has been fixed since, I want to say like March or April at least.
Okay, yeah, that came from the experiments my master's students did, and that was indeed around that time.
Okay, yeah, because since then all that driver's been moved to NetIF F was hardware CSUM, so that's not an issue anymore.
Okay, thank you.
Is that not an issue in IXGB, or as Tom said, as he said, the stack sets the encapsulation data and they reset the inner transporter to... No. Does it have to be fixed in every driver?
It doesn't actually need to be an encapsulation thing. So what it was is the IPv6 header, the IXGBE driver was always trying to figure out what the protocol was because the hardware says it only supports TCP or UDP. Really what they meant by that is we either support, what is it, like I think it's like, I'm trying to remember the offsets, it's like a 6-byte offset from the starter checksum or like an 8, I think, for TCP, something like that. And so that's what the code's been changed to since then. It's just, okay, look at the offset and just do the checksum based off the offset instead of trying to guess what the actual protocol is. The problem was in that case, it was just a literal interpretation of, well, the hardware says it only does TCP or UDP, so we were scanning all the way through the packet to try to find out if it was TCP or UDP. And that's where things are getting tripped up.
Question, so you say you're going to be submitting this. Last time I checked, there's kind of still a little bit of a religious war inside the ITF about whether it's even allowed to add extension headers. If they like change their minds again, what are you going to do? Just change the implementation?
Well, I'm not sure this discussion includes encapsulation. So if you encapsulate a packet and put an extension header within the encapsulation, I think that's fine.
I think everyone's okay with that particular approach, yes. But they just wanted to insert that segment header directly, and some people are really upset about that.
Well, the idea is that to insert the segment header directly, only the end host can do that. And, well, the implementation supports the insertion of directly the SRH in the middle of the path because, well, some guys from the industry do it anyway, regardless of the specification, but I agree that it should not be the case.
Personally, it makes sense to me, but...
Seeing quite a lot of performance problems in HTTP code, which from time to time uses CRC32 checksumming, did you check or how much of a problem is HMAC verification in the FastPass?
Yeah, so we measured that the HMAC verification impacted the performance by about 20%.
Okay, thanks. And which parts are actually covered by the HMAC? So do you actually have the next segment pointer covered by it? So
yeah.
So you need to recalculate it on every hop?
Well, the idea is that you only check the HMAC on the edge router, so that it has been verified, and so core routers do not need to check it again. And the HMAC covers the source address of the IPv6 header and everything, basically all the segments, the first segment pointer, and some flags.
Okay, so basically you need to recalculate if you change the first segment, the first segment, if you change it, you need to recalculate.
But you do not change it. It is not supposed to change. It simply points to this one so that you know which is the first segment of your path. This field should not change.
Which field is the one where you...
This one.
And this one is covered or it's not covered?
No, it's not covered.
It's not covered. So basically you just ingress verifies it and then you just change it on the hops itself.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
No more questions? Okay, thanks everyone.